Is it seen by everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let us proceed. So last session, guys, we have seen this structured procedures and initial statement and example also we have seen. And this port and data declaration and initialization, that also we have seen. That is, how do we initialize this reg this way? So this is this portion. So that also we have seen last session. And ANSI style 2005, inside this port list area itself. So how we declare that and how we initialize, that also we have seen. Coming to the always, this also we have covered. Procedural assignment, this also we have covered, like a part select, bit select, concatenation. So that we have seen. Blocking assignments we have seen. And what is non-blocking assignment, that also we have seen. Application of non-blocking assignment, that is important, that also we have seen. So with this example, that is non-blocking assignment, how it is helping us to eliminate race conditions, that we have seen. And this is another example, guys. Today we'll start with this example. The last session we have covered this race condition. How we are overcoming this one with the help of this non-blocking assignment operator. Today we will see further this non-blocking, usage of non-blocking and usage of blocking with an example. This example, that is a shift register example. So before going to this example, what is that we have to understand here is from this figure. When there is a clock applied, you have applied your clock simultaneously to this one and to this one and to this one and to this one. There are four flip-flops. We have applied our clock to all these four flops, flip-flops. Now, what is our intention is, this serial in, this one, should go inside here. So during this, what is that going to happen? You can understand that is switching theory and logic design we already have studied. So what is that we understand is during this clock here, this value is taken to here, and the value that is present earlier will go as an input to this one here. So, and this value will be seen here, and the value that is already present will be going as an input to this one here. So, and this value will be present here as a new value, and the previous value, what is that already available here, will be going as an output here. And the value that is present is discarded. So that's how the shifting is actually happening. That is the intended shift register functionality that we are trying to understand the usage of blocking and non-block. So what would be the impact of that? So let us proceed to understand with the help of this example here. In this example here, if you see here, we have clock, your serial in data, and the queue. Of course, there are several things here which are actually practically, and this code is not perfect. This is not perfect for practical implementation. Can anyone guess why it is not practical for practical implementation? Why it is not perfect? Can anyone guess there?
The non-blocking, the memory usage.
No. Carefully observe. I just give you 10 seconds. I start countdown. Yeah, everyone carefully observe this this code from line number 1 to line number 15. Carefully observe this one. This is not a perfect. This is not a perfect code for practical implementation. Why it is not perfect? That is the question. So your time starts now. 10 seconds. Everybody carefully observe this one. So 10, 9, 8. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
The reset condition is not there.
Absolutely. That's good. That's good observation. So reset condition is not there. That's the problem. So guys, here, those who tried hard to answer, kindly observe. We have real-time circuits. Real-time means physically available with us. So the moment you give power to this one here, this one flip-flop you are operating, when we talk about STLD sort of subjects, we never talk about the power. We simply say there is a clock signal. We applied the clock signal. So, and some input I gave at this, and some output I'm obtaining this one. And I have some signal called reset. And when I press this reset, and this is to a known state, maybe 0, maybe 1, that manual that vendor will give. When you press the reset, it will go to the state 1 or state 0. That is through the data sheet we obtain that information. Through the manual that we obtain, the manufacturer of this D flip flop fellow will give us that. When you press reset, what may happen? Some flip flops may have preset all this. So you can preset to some value. So anyway, the point here is, when we discuss STL, switching to the logic design, we never talk about the VDD that we had to provide in order transistors to work inside. After all, this D flip-flop, what is there? We have transistors. We have maybe maybe N transistors. So though you are giving input to here, this input is not seen at this output in a inverted form unless you provide not here VDD, and this is not grounded properly. Then there is no scope of seeing this input in an inverted form at this output side. So there is a required VDD is essential, and proper grounding is also essential apart from the playing with the input alone. So that is the point here. That is the one thing that. So now the point here is, what I'm trying to make here is, when you power on this one, so to which state it goes, that also an engineer, RTL developer, should carefully design. RTL, this entire portion, who has developed it? RTL developer. RTL developer has developed. He or she has to look into practical aspects of the circuit also. Simply, they cannot design. Practical side also, they have to see. When you power on, it should go to a known state. So that is missing here. If you see carefully here, if you observe carefully here, you have used the clock here. And if you come here, this one, Q, just because the reason you are assigning in the always statement here, this Q is being assigned here, and all these Q values are assigned here. For that reason, this reg declaration is required. So that we have done. So by default, this reg is having a value called X. So whatever the input that you give here, possibly this may obtain when during a positive edge of the clock, when the positive edge of the clock occurred, this block is triggered. So at that time, the input, since this Cin is given externally by the user, so possibly that external given with that, this first of this Q may be updated. But what about this one? Q0, Q1, Q2? What about them? Because as we already seen in the previous sessions, that the power of this non-blocking assignment operator is, it reads first. What it does? It reads the values. It reads the values here. And then it reads the values and then stores them. And then assigns. So it reading. During reading, this is coming externally from the input. But what about them? The default value is X. So X is getting assigned here. So which is not correct. So we have to take, when we power on, to a known state. That is done through this reset signal. that is done through this reset. So that state is missing. So that is the observation that we have to make as a RTL observer. Anyway, keeping aside that bug, we let us call it as a bug. Keeping aside that bug, our intention is to discuss this non-blocking assignment effect here. That is what our intention. So if you look carefully, what is really happening is this one, two, three, and four. We have total four flip-flops here. So all these four flip-flops here, the new value that is serial in is coming here when you apply the clock here. When you apply the clock here, the serial in is available here. The old value of Q of 0, that this is the Q of 0, if you let us say this is the Q of 0, old value of the Q of 0 is going here as a new value to this Q of 1. But the old value of the Q of 1 is going here as a Q of 2. Old value of Q of 2 is going as a Q of 3 here. So meaning what? This is happening parallelly here. The parallel behavior of this real-time circuit, physical circuit, real-time circuit is here and modeled here. It is modeled here. Practically, I mean, RTL level, it is modeled. What is modeled? What is described? Modeled means in the previous sessions, I said several times, description. So you successfully described here with the power of this non-blocking assignment operator. That is the point here. Now, if you go here, that is this one. Now, this is, if you see here carefully, what is that we have used? What is that we have used? Hello?
Blocking assignment.
Yes, the blocking assignment operator we have used. Meaning what? First, this will be anyway, it needs to get executed so that the other can be. So it means what? This is assigned to Q of 0. After that, it is going to line 10. Meaning what? Q of 0 is now having a this one. So this is actually this one. It is going to this one. And then after 11th one will be executed. Meaning this is going here again. So that way, actually our intention is not made. This parallel is not met here. It is only one flip-flop, that is you are giving, what is that you are giving? Yes in, and you have obtaining yes in here, when you apply the clock. So one can, I request everyone there, Xilinx, so those who are having installed in their laptop or desktop, kindly try this tool I will share possibly today. If you have, on internet also you'll get this one, not issue. So you kindly try. Only the thing that you have to change here is, what is the change you have to make here is, when you come here up, at this portion here, you have to put a begin, and if reset, let us say it's an active high reset, if reset this Q as a 0, else everything is fine, else begin end. Else begin end, everything is fine. Else this begin end. And finally, this begin needs to be ended here. One more end is required here. One more end is required. And here you have to declare as a reset, because the reset you are taking here using, and after this clock, and you don't terminate with this semicolon, you put a reset. And that's it. That's the arrangement that you have to do. And then you can simulate, and you can see that it's just passed. And then you can synthesize, and synthesized already we have demonstrated first how to see that technology schematic. You see the technology schematic effect, and you come to this code. Even in this code, you make changes that reset like that only, but ensure that you're synthesizing and also simulating. What is the effect that you see? You can notice it very easily. So that is what, be careful. The takeaway from this two examples is, while we are dealing with sequential circuits where flip-flops are there, so at that time you cannot take risk, you cannot think as a programmer, like a C++ programmer. You are a designer, hardware designer, so think in a hardware perspective. That is, parallel mechanism is required. That parallel mechanism comes only through this non-blocking assignment operator. So ensure wherever there is a POSH, wherever there is a negate sort of thing inside, never try blocking assignment operator. Always use non-blocking assignment operator. That is the standard thumb rule. Wherever you see POSH, wherever you see negate, inside you have to use only non-blocking assignment operator. That is the thumb rule. We avoid any sort of unintentional hardware generation. Our intention is not only to see the simulation results and be happy, also a correct hardware also should come out of the synthesizer. So that is the takeaway from these two examples. So now let us proceed to this one. Sequential and parallel blocks. So these sequential blocks, let us go straight to the instead this theory. If somebody typing in the chat window, kindly don't type, unmute and talk, because some sounds like message sounds are coming. So guys, are you people there? Is that disconnected?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So now straight we are coming to the sequential block. In sequential block, we use the keyword begin and end. That is the that's how you notice what is sequential block. You use that begin and end. And what is parallel block? You use fourth and join. So wherever you see this fourth join and wherever you see begin end, the moment you have seen, it is a sequential block. Wherever you have seen this fourth join, it is a parallel block. That is the one point that one must know. And the second point is, inside the sequential block, you will have the effect of usage of this one and this one. This one is a, you know very well, it's a blocking assignment operator, and you know very well this is a non-blocking assignment operator. Where do you see the effect of these two? Only in a sequential blocks. And inside this fork and join, this one and this one are not having any impact. You use either this one blocking assignment operator or non-blocking assignment operator. There is no impact of this assignment operators. All statements are executed parallelly inside the fork and join. That's it. You use this one, that is blocking assignment operator, or non-blocking assignment. But inside the sequential, if you use this one after another, if you use this one, parallel. That is the second point that we have to understand. And the third point is, all designs means RTL means all that is synthesizable. All RTL means all synthesizable. We'll use sequential, maybe this one, but sequential blocks, that is with a begin and end. Maybe begin and end. And no synthesizable code uses parallel blocks. That is the third one. So guys, let us quickly summarize. First point is, you see in a sequential, begin and end. In a parallel, you see fork and join. That is the first point. Second point is, the effect of this will be there only in sequential, and the effect of this will not be there in a parallel. That is the second point. The third point is, This is a synthesizable and this is a not synthesizable. That is the third. Only for simulation purposes, we use how the behavior of the, if we want to see, then we can use it. But not for the synthesis purposes. Where you are developing for RTL, then you have to avoid usage of this parallel blocks. That is the third point. So let us proceed to see the examples. So this example, if you see carefully, we have taken begin and end. And you know very well, because this has come in the previous lectures, we have spoken about hash. Hash is a delay control operator. We've spoken about that. So this is F5, the simulation completes its simulation time 5, this one. So it is cumulatively added up. Why cumulatively added up? Just because of the reason we are using this one. What is this equal? It's a blocking. That's why it is cumulatively added, this one. After 5, it is 15. after 15 it is 35, like that. But if you see the other example here, this other example, it's the same, like we are using this one same example, no change at all, same example. Only thing is begin and end, instead of begin and end we are having fourth enter. Are having fourth entry. Same example. But as been said, this and this will not be having any impact if you use fork and join. That's why if you see this is at 5 and this is at 10, this is at 20. Parallelly, all these are execution is happening parallelly. No sequential. In case of sequential one after another, then cumulatively this time will be at that. So this is the point in the parallelogram. So now the point here is, I'm just asking everyone to do from home, is this code, what you have to do is you have to simulate in your simulator, whatever that earlier we demonstrated, EDA playground and Xilinx. So either one, okay. If you have some other simulator, that is also okay. But try to simulate this one, this code. Only thing required here is you have to have here module and some name. So let us say PB parallel block is the name, and inside this every code, this code will go inside it, and then end module. That's it. You simulate this one. See the simulation results. At 5 you will see Y being assigned with 1. At 10 you will see Z being assigned with X and Y contains, and at 20 you will see this W being assigned with this one. And the same way you also try from home, just put a module and you call it as SB, serial block, and then end module, that's it. And you simulate this behavior from home. This you work, and there are several assignments type of thing. And earlier also this behavior, that is shift register behavior using blocking assignment operator and non-blocking assignment operator. This also you can test. This you can synthesize and simulate, but this you only can simulate. Which one? This one is not for synthesis. This is not for synthesis. You only can simulate. So guys there, especially new learners, kindly try this. Don't neglect today itself, you try. So moving on, this special features of blocks. So what is that blocks here? We have seen, right? Just now, parallel blocks and sequential blocks. So some features are there associated with this. So nested blocks, named blocks, and disabling of a named blocks. These are the features. Nested means you can have begin, inside you can have fork, inside you can have join, and inside you can have fork, like that. So in this fork, join, inside here also you can have begin. And here you can have end, because join has come here. Now this begin started here. Somewhere you can end possibly. Here also you may end. If you want to extend further, you can end here also. And this fork needs to be ended here. So all these are the capabilities of the language for simulation purpose. Again, I'm telling you, all this nested, everything is for only simulation. To see the behavior, if you have some thought in your mind, how that could be. So you just put that thought into the translation of this language, translate that thought into the language this way you translate your idea here like that, and simulate it. You cannot synthesize it. Later on for synthesis you have to again further you have to work how this behavior can be translated to synthesizable code. But first of all, whether your simulation, whether your idea is working or not, you can see it, you can check. But remember, nested blocks such way is not for synthesis, only for simulation. Now, named blocks. So, named blocks, if you see here, initial, this begin we have put here. And we are putting a colon here. If you notice a colon here, there is a colon here. So, after a colon, we have a block one, something like that, block one, if you see the block one. So this is called named block. What is the use of this named block means? Inside this, wherever you started the block here like that, you can have your type declaration, some variable declaration. such as this, in this case, this is the integer, and you declare something here, I. So this is local to only this initial block, only local to this initial block. If you declare at the module top, at the declaration level here, this integer, if you put here, that is global. Anywhere till end module, if need be, you can use that integer variable here. Integer variables you can use. But inside this block, the way here, as the example presented, you see here, such one are local to only that portion here. That port, that is called named block. This one. So that is named block. Now coming to this nested also, we spoke disable named block. So you see somewhere possibly we might have used here. If you see this block example here, started from this one 1, 2, 6, and then moving here like that because enough space is not there. I have put it this way. Now if you see the point here, what I'm trying to make, seventh point, if you see carefully, seventh line. Begin block 1, and we started this while, and I less than 16 begin if flag this is I. What is flag here? Flag has got total how many bits? Total 16 bits. We have put inside the flag total 16 bits. This is underscore is allowed in the language for readability. You don't need to put continuously 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 like that. For readability, anywhere you can put this underscore. So but anyway, the point here of what I'm trying to make here is here 4 total 16. Now what we are doing here is this I less than 16, meaning I already initialized with a 0. So 0 to 15, that is nothing but this 16 we have covered. So whenever that is flag I, meaning is that true? True nothing but what is the meaning true? If it is 1, begin, display encountered a true bit at element number, this percentage DI. Disable block. So you are disabling the moment you have detected 1 in this sequence of bits. So you are disabling that after displaying this message. You thought of first wherever that let 1 occur. You thought of stopping after detection. You thought of not detect further anymore. So that's your idea. So what you have done is you started with a begin, and you gave the named block, and you are disabling here. So the intended functionality is met. You use a disable keyword you use, and you use this block 1 here, the named block. Name, what is the name you give to this block? This is the block. To this block you give the name block 1. So it is very much allowed here this way. So these are the three features, guys. Here we have three features here somewhere. These are the three features. Why these three features are there, where they are helpful and all, everything is for simulation purpose. And there is named blocks are allowed in the synthesis also. They will not cause any problem. Named blocks are allowed in synthesis also, but they will not cause any problem. Only major is all three are used in simulation. And if you use somewhere named block in the synthesis RTL code, then that will not cause a much problem. You can use for readability. Huge 1,000 lines code, 2,000 lines code is there. Which block is which? What is what for that purpose is? In that case, you can have colon, and you can this is add block, and this is a multiplication block. Like that, you can have names, and then you go for synthesis. Such a code again still acceptable by the synthesizer. It will give you a proper hardware. No issues with that. So, but the other things are major purposes for me. That is the point that I'm trying to make. So, that is the features. These are the features. Now we move to our Verilog HDL loops. Loops There are four types of looping statements in Verilog. So we have all this. While loop, for loop, repeat, for it. So syntax and all, we'll see now. Here we go for this. This is having a keyword while itself. While loop having a syntax while itself. And you have your this one here, count. Condition you are checking. What is that? Basically, this how you put, how you use while loop is this expression. Let us say this is the expression. If expression is true, then you can enter into the loop. This is your loop. Since here multiple statements are there, this is one, this is two. Multiple statements are there. We are having this begin and end. Otherwise, begin and end are not required. That is another observation that we have to have. Begin and end is just used because we have multiple statements, more than one statement. If only one statement, this begin and end is not required. And what is the syntax? How you use while loop? While, open the parenthesis, open this parenthesis, inside put an expression that you want to check. What is the expression that you want to check? If this expression is true, then only this it enters into the loop. So another thing is, if you see this one, loop variable, we are incrementing inside. And then we are going here and checking. That's how this is made here, this loop is. This may not be the case all the time required, but the all the time, what is the required condition is expression must be true in order to get into this loop. As long as expression is true, this loop will exist. That's how the syntax is. This is a while loop executes until while expression becomes false. If that is false, the moment it is false, it comes out of this while loop. And whatever the expression is here, it goes there. So another example. This is, I think we have seen already. But though already seen here, what is that? Another here the point to understand is more than one condition here. Multiple conditions are checked here. That is the observation. Here you check it. You are checking only one condition, right? You can have more than one condition check also. While I is less than 16, this I you initialize here, and this continue also you are checking. Continue only you have kept, meaning whether it is true or false, that is tested. True or false means it must be some number other than 0 or other than x. So, but in this case, we have this continue in, as 1. So, this is 1 and this is already we initialized with 0. Multiple conditions. The basically idea is here. What is the example? The point of discussing this is multiple conditions we can check. The moment you want to come out of, when this condition is met, what is that you are looking for? You put here. After that, you make that condition false, being inside the loop itself. Then when it goes here, then since you made that condition false after your intended functionality, then this will become false, then it comes out of the loop and it goes to the other statements followed by the loop. So from these two examples, what I'm trying to emphasize is why first point is this one, that is while is itself the keyword. That is the one thing. Syntax is open the parentheses and keep inside that expression. If the expression is true, then set of statements, whatever that you thought of looking after, you can put inside that. Since set of statements are there, you have to have begin and end. That is the point, that one point that I want to make. The other point is this loop condition, you not only one here the way it is demonstrated, it can be more than one condition check also. It can be more than one condition check also. So that is the second point that I am trying to bring to. So now coming to the for loop. For loop here, these three three internally these three tasks are there. This is one, and this is second one, and this is the third. These three, an initial condition. This is the initial condition. Every for loop, how it is? For is a keyword. For is a keyword, and open the parenthesis. Inside, whatever that loop index, let us say this is in this example, so the count is used. Count. We have to initialize that one. First thing is we have to initialize. Initialize with whatever the value, no, not necessarily zero. That according to your requirement, whatever the value that you want to initialize, but initialize. Check to see if the terminating condition is true. So check whether this condition is true or false. A procedural assignment to change the value of the control variable is required. Control variable is required. So it comes here, fourth line, and then when it is going back here, this is done. This is done. I mean, 0 plus 1 is done, and then it checks the condition. After doing that, if that is true, then again it comes to the statements. Again, the same story that multiple statements are there means we have to have begin and end. So that is the story. So this is how the for loop is. We are not at this point. What I am trying to make here is about the language, guys. A lot more to discuss here. For example, just a moment, guys. There, I said in my previous sessions also, one side of the coin is understanding the language. The other side of the story is developing the code. And this code itself has got divided into one is RTL, the other is for simulation, that is test match. This RTL, nothing but several times in my past sessions also I said, it is synthesizable, acceptable by the synthesizer. So that is synthesizable. So it must be a synthesizer, this RTL. Meaning what? If all languages are learning a language constructs, such as this is a construct, while is a construct. While is a construct, while is a keyword. So this language, you are learning. And you are learning here, this is a for loop. You are learning this initial. What is the point that all the time you have to ask yourself is whether that is synthesizable or not. That is the point that you have to ask. Whether that is synthesizable or not. Whether that is to be used in ASIC designs or whether to use in FPGA design. What is that? This construct. If I use in FPGA design, what is the impact of using a for loop in the FPGA design? What is the impact of using for loop in the ASIC design? In that perspective is necessary. Simply language learning means it is not C or C++ we are learning. Or nowadays, some other languages, new languages, that are Python and all. We are learning a hardware, how to model the hardware. As a part of this hardware learning, what we have to question all the time, RTL, whether RTL is possible or not. RTL is possible or not means whether the code, if I develop using this for loop, whether that is synthesizable or not. That is the question that everyone must ask. Without asking that, simply learning language is of no use. Guys, there, very be serious about that. So, just a moment. Now, coming to here, one point you must notice, I forgot to tell. That point is, you use this while, right? Here at 9, line number 9. Remember, that has come inside the initial. That has come inside the initial. Initial, you started with this begin. Now started this 1, 2, 3, and then 4, and then 5, all that you started. Somewhere you are ending this here. Here you are ending this begin. here you are entering. So the point what I'm trying to make here is this: while you cannot write without this initial, simply with, for a while, if you imagine, new learners especially, without this line here, this begin and end, if they start coding like this, flag I thinking is acceptable to the simulator, at least if not for the synthesizer, at least if it is acceptable for the simulator, then it is not acceptable even to the simulator. The reason is this initial you did not use. That is the problem. So while loop or any loop, all these loops, they come in a initial or always. That is the point that we have to notice, not simply seeing that whatever going. So inside initial, you can have maybe forever repeat or per or what. We can have. Inside always you can have that. Without initial, without always, standalone for loops, if you start writing for I equal to 0 like that, the simulator, forget about the synthesizer, simulator tool, we have the tools, right? Simulator is different and synthesizer is different, right? In the past, several times we spoke about. So even simulator will not accept. So that's the observation is required. And think about that, what I said, that whether this is acceptable to the synthesizer, while loop is simple or not. Answer you have to get. You get the answer tomorrow. Tomorrow we are having the class. Actually, according to our regular, we are not having class on Saturday, Sunday, but we are having tomorrow. Because we have to complete several things by this weekend. That is tomorrow itself. So, it is sensible or not, that you question. Here also, you question here whether this is sensible or not. Again, I am telling you here, a SIG point of view that is different. Again, FPGA point of view that is different. So guys, that is important point here. Now let us come to this portion here. This is again the for loop here. For loop here, but what is that you notice here? What is that you notice here? Anyone, you kindly answer what this is, backward defined? Someone answer?
Compiler directive.
That's great. So, remember guys, those who are not aware, wherever you have used this compiler directive, this is your macro, this one. And wherever you are trying to use this max underscore state, you should have this backcode. Without this backcode, simply this max underscore states you cannot use here, without this backcode. So that is the important thing, that is one observation in this example. And any other here? This is another observation, that inside initial only you have used this for loop. So,
sir, we could have defined it as parameter, no sir, max states.
Yes, we can do that. But usage of parameter, usage of backward defined, parameterized module section has come. There we spoke a lot. Were you there at that time? Parameterized module?
Yes, sir.
So the parameter has got a different purpose. And this backward defined, that is a compiler direct, someone answered. This has got different purpose. This different purpose is, already we spoke, since you asked for completeness, I am answering this one, because already we covered that one in the parameterized module. This one here, you cannot, the intention is to make this one here in this current module, that is the one thing, that is the point number one, is this max underscore state is only inside this current module, whatever you wrote, that is the point number one. Point number two is, it cannot be altered from outside, in some module you are instantiating this current module, suppose. So here you thought of passing a value to this max states. So you cannot do so. The parameter keyword intention is to make a generic definition of the module. Generic definition. Generic means like copies. We can make multiple copies. The bricks, people are making bricks. So what they do, they keep something with them. In that they pour the cement or whatever. Multiple copies they keep producing. So like that, this parameter usage, if you make here, current here, somewhere in the other module, you can alter this parameter, the copies you can produce here, and the power is not only copies, it allows to alter to any number that, suppose 16 bit, you can alter to 160 bit also. 16 bit, the current generic module is only for 16 bit, but with the power of parameter overriding, that is called parameter overriding, with that you can make it work for 160 also, or 360 also, whatever the N, that's why we call it as a N. So that power comes with the parameter. The purpose of parameter is, the intention for having a parameter in the language is this, that parameterized modules, to make a parameterized module, generic modules, to build generic modules. That is the intention, that is the purpose that we have. And with the help of parameter, that such a code is synthesizable. So in a code, wherever you are instantiating, this is synthesizable. This is not synthesizable. This usage is not synthesizable. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
And we forgot that time to discuss about local param. No one questioned there. Later on, I realized that I missed this local param. Anyone having idea about local param, can you please tell?
We cannot change by using the def param like that. We use the local param.
That's great. Local param, if you use inside the parameter somewhere, the way we used in earlier demonstrations, the parameter and count and the value, some count, let us say 10. And this count 10, we could able to override it by instantiating through module instantiation or def param, using def param keyword. So we can alter that, being outside from different modules. Either use the def param or module instantiation, through module instantiation. But if you use instead of parameter, if you put a local, let us put here, local param, and then you put a count, and then 10, this, such a module, outside if you try to override, it is not possible. Local param keyword is local to only this current module. So that is the point, local param. And the backward def, not only for such usage, just a moment, here on this. Backward define this compiler directive is not only for such usage. It is also in the simulator, in some simulators, if you write let us say, just a moment. We'll demonstrate later on, not today. Some other day I will demonstrate. Here, if you use data flow level model, data flow model, using def, this is backward defined, and not backward defined, that is, if define, backward defined, and I am using here data, df, data flow, and backward end define, if defined. This we have backward if defined and data flow, and you put a data flow here and end define, backward end define, and backward if defined, and a behavioral level modeling, and the entire code here, and a backward end define in a single module. In that we have both. In the compiler directive, we can tell here plus define plus data flow while running the simulation. Then this portion will be treated by the compiler. And if you change this to behavioral level modeling BM, and only this portion will be treated by the compiler. So for such purposes also compiler directives are used. Compiler directives not only is so far what we have seen, that is the backward time scale we have seen, that is also a compiler directive. And we have seen backward include in during that EDA playground. At that time also we said about backcode include. This so far we have seen only this. Now we are seeing in the past also we have seen backcode defined. Now also we are seeing only three we have seen so far. To type in internet Google Verilog compiler directives, there are a bunch of will come. I think more than 16 or more than 25 are there. Compiler directives. But the point here, we are slightly deviating from the discussion. The point here, backward define, I think the person who asked, he got that parameter we can use here, but the usage of backward define from the outside, we cannot alter. Parameterized module, we cannot make. That is the biggest problem. Usage of backward define. Usage of backward define, we cannot override. Overriding is possible with the parameter. Can we use parameter here? Means answer is yes. There is no denial you can use. Then why we have used this means our intention here is some demonstrating. What is the demonstrating here? For loop. We are demonstrating for loop. Our intention is not to discuss about the parameter issue. Parameter overriding, why parameter is used. That is not the agenda. Agenda is to discuss the for loop. This for loop. As a part of this for loop, we have put this one. Can we use parameter? The answer is very much yes. You use a parameter, and this max underscore, what is that? States. But this time you cannot put a space and 32. You have to equal 32. And then semicolon. That is the syntax, because syntax is like that. Parameter max underscore states equal to 32 semicolon. That you can replace here. Very much happily you can use. I think hopefully this is answered. Is that clear? Is that clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
So, but the only thing you have to remember, if you use backward define, this we should not forget. This usage we should not forget. This tiny small backward, you see here. That backward we should not forget. If you forget that backward, then problem will come. The tool will not understand, it will throw error. In case parameter if you are using, then you don't need this small backward, is not required if you use the parameter. And the parameter, if you use this keyword, will be replaced with a parameter, and gap is not allowed, equal to, and then semicolon. That much care you have to take if you use the parameter. No problem usage of parameter. So moving ahead with this, what we are trying to demonstrate, repeat loop now. So let us quickly, please wrap this today, forever and repeat very quickly. Guys, just 5 minutes, we wrap at least loops. Then later on we can move to the this ASIC, FPGA, synthesizable, all that discussion tomorrow session we carry out. Today introducing all that Verilog loops, let us wrap this discussion here. Repeat is another loop here. We are using, see the syntax here, repeat. And how many times we planned to run some code, how many times it should iteratively it should happen. So that code, what is that you are in your mind? You may be having, there are guys, 5 guys are attending our class, suppose. I'm the one, so total put together 6 guys. So you may have different 5 ideas. I'm plus one, my idea. So depending upon that idea, what code should go here, we put that one. And how many times I want to run, depending upon you 5 people, depending upon me, another here, that how many times anyway, that time figure, number, it is not an expression. Guys, earlier we had an expression where in a while loop, you cannot have a number. You cannot anywhere, you cannot have simply number. Simply number you cannot. Expression, it is expression, a condition check expression. If it is true, then loop will be. If it is false, then you come out of the loop. But in this case, where is that? Repeat case, it's a pure number. How many times I want to repeat? It's a pure number. But the observation should be there here. All the time, it should be in the initial or always, guys. Without this, we cannot have this repeat. Meaning, without that meaning, earlier also I said several times, without this initial, let us say, this is not there, this is not there. Simply from line number 4, count, repeat, this is the allowed means, this is not allowed. Compiler will throw error. So you have to have your initial or always, inside initial or always only, we can have this. Again, the question you have to ask yourself, we are not learning C, C++, we are learning hardware, how to describe. Then question comes whether it is synthesizable or not. This part tomorrow you people will be answering. Anyway, I am going to cover tomorrow, but meanwhile, I'm just telling you people that how ASIC will treat that the loops, and how if you are going for the FPGA approach, how that loops are created by the FPGA tool. There are EDA tools, right? Electronic Design Automation tools, FPGA. For example, our XST, Xilinx Synthesis Technology, is a tool. ASIC, for example, Genus. Genus is from Cadence people. Earlier, it was called RTL compiler. So these tools, whether they support this to be synthesizable? Synthesizable means whether they give us a gate level netlist. That is the question that we have to have before using these loops for development of a RTL. So you blindly cannot develop RTL just because you know the usage of this loop. You have to answer ask yourself that whether usage of such a loop is synthesizable. That you have to know. That is the key to success in the digital IC domain. So guys, that's how this repeat is. Let's move quickly for the forever loop. Again, this forever, if you see, observe carefully line two here. You have the keyword forever. It's a for space ever. This is not correct. So forever together it is. Most of the new learners make a mistake. End module. They don't write together. They write end space module, and the simulator or synthesis tool will be giving errors. They have failed to understand that end module is a together one word it is. They write separate words. End is a separate, module is a separate. They keep writing, giving a space. So likewise, forever, for space, ever, no. The forever together is one word it is. So guys, again, the observation I'm telling you is initial. Under initial, it is there here. And since multiple statements are there, begin and end is required. And now here in this case, if you see in the previous examples, this portion is a clock generating. We are generating the clock here. So we even generated the clock using, this is sort of just giving you understanding initial, that is, let's say clock equal to zero. And with the help of always also we can generate the same. It is replaced by single statement like hash 10, that is the CLK is the negation of CLK. These two are replaced with this one. This initial one, 2, 3, and then 4. These 4 are replaced by this 1 and 2 only, guys. For generation of the clock, 1, 2, 3, 4 are replaced by 1, 2 only, guys. Here. But the thing is, we have to notice again, what is that question again? Synthesizable and non-synthesizable, that's the one question that you have to ask. And how long this will run? That is another issue here. If you use the forever, initial, one more time, CLK equal to zero, and always, and here if you put a CLK, negation of CLK, without timing here, if you put without timing, what happens? Anyone answers? What happens? If I don't put a time here, then what happens to such code if I try to simulate? Can anyone answer?
It will take X.
Uh-huh.
Clock will be there in unknown state.
Can you be louder? Just some disturbance.
Group will be in X statement.
Not unknown state. It is there, no? We initialize zero.
Simulation time won't advance.
That's the correct answer. Simulation time will not advance because when it is running here, it is running in the zero simulation time itself. Since time we did not mention, here simulation started at zero time unit. So what we are expecting, simulation results, we are expecting somewhere simulation should run and it should give some results here at different interval of time. But since we did not put the time here, simulation is running. It is running. But in the zero simulation time, it keeps repeating. Simulation will not end. It is running. Infinitely it is running. But it is not proceeding. Since it is not proceeding, you will not see anything. Why? Just because you did not put the time. This always is running infinitely. So don't put the time. So that's why this time is important here. If you put a hash 5, then it happens. That simulation will proceed now. You will see whatever that. So that is what here also happens. Forever, though you have put this hash 10, anyway you may be getting this one. But if you don't have one more here, so this will run in infinitely again, keep running. By default simulator, wherever it ends, there it ends. But if you thought of stopping somewhere, then what you have to have is initial hash, let us say 100. There where I thought of stopping. $finish or $stop. If you don't have this one, by default, how long simulator has to run? It may run, or some simulators, if default value not there, it will be keep running only. So you cannot stop that this forever behavior. In order to control this forever behavior, write an initial and how long, how many cycles of the clock you want. You may want some 1,000 cycles. So put 1,000 and then there where it stops, somewhere 1,000 it will stop. So guys, with this, what we today did is we introduced you the summary of today's is this one. Blocking and non-blocking, how dangerous they are. Usage of blocking assignment in the sequential circuits, how dangerous. That is the one thing that we learned today. The other thing that we learned is sequential block, parallel block, and they are synthesis we use in RTL and we use only in simulation. That is the second thing that we learned. And the third thing is the impact will not be there equal, that is blocking and non-blocking assignment operators. Impact will not be seen in the parallel blocks, and the impact will be seen only in sequential blocks. That is the third thing that we learned. And this code you can simulate from home. That is the assignment to you people given. This code also assignment to you people given. And earlier the shift register code also given to you people as a assignment. This one here, this non-blocking usage and blocking usage. And coming to the final discussion, we have seen today loops, various loops are there. This also we have seen, nested blocks and named blocks and disabling. This also we have seen, and then loops we have seen. In the loops, what we have primarily learned is usage we learned today. Tomorrow, what are synthesizable and what are not synthesizable, and ASIC point of view and FPGA point of view, or overall what is synthesizable and what is not synthesizable. That one tomorrow we'll see.